Hey there! Is today your first time here? Or maybe your first time in a while? If so, maybe you're wondering exactly who we are and what this church is all about. Well, we'd like you to know that we're a group of ordinary people who are on an amazing journey together, following Christ. Our guide is the Bible because it's the divinely inspired Word of God and it will never take us in the wrong direction. Along the way, we hope you'll see that we are welcoming and spiritually passionate and that getting to know you is a big deal to us. We know that the road is rough sometimes, but we'll work really hard to bring you practical and relevant messages to equip and encourage you through life's ups and downs. We want you to know that we care about this community, and we believe that it's our job to make it a better place. So, no matter who you are or where you've been, we're glad you're here with us today. And we hope that you'll join us on our journey, following Christ and living out His plan for us. So, welcome to church.
With your friend and brother, Pastor and Dr. John Boyd. I'm so glad to have this opportunity to come into your homes, your cars, your jobs, wherever this broadcast is finding you on this Wednesday afternoon. My friends, this is Faith Clinic. It's my opportunity to build your faith. The Bible says it is an impossibility to please God without faith. And faith comes by hearing, and hearing what? The Word of God. So I want to bless you in the Word today as we're in this tremendous time here at New Greater Bethel Ministries. We're located at 215-32 Jamaica Avenue in Queens Village, New York. That's 215-32 Jamaica Avenue in Queens Village, New York, 11428. Okay. Now, as many of you may know, or you may not know, we are on our Holy Week fast, and it's tremendous. We have prayer every day at 6 o'clock, and you can join us today. Now, today we're in our, as I think we're entering in our fourth day of the fast, and we're on Daniel. That's one meal after 6 p.m. That's fruits and veggies, herbal teas or water or smoothies. But we're just dedicating ourselves over to the Lord at this time. And we're in prayer. The Bible says the effectual, fervent prayer of the righteous does one thing. It avails much. And I'm sure you need God to do some things in your life. So even if you didn't start with us, you can still join in today. And while I'm talking about joining, make sure you share today. Share with somebody. Call somebody. Tell them to get online. Say, Pastor Boyd is teaching and building our faith. Now, don't forget, today is also Wednesday. And this is an exciting Wednesday. As you know, I've been doing this incredible teach, and it is incredible, on A Tale of Three Kings. This is written by Gene Edwards. It has to be one of my all-time favorite books. It's an easy read, but it's a powerful read. And some of you who wanted the book, we do have some more. And you can see Sister Keisha when you get in today. And you know, service for prayer will be from 6 to 7. Then 7 o'clock, we'll be setting up for the production. So tonight, I am going to be, well, this book is coming alive right in your face. So you don't want to be just online. You want to, if you can be here, you want to be in the house. As our good brother, part of our youth department over production, Emmanuel Ennis, will be playing David. I, Pastor Boyd. In my acting debut for many of you will be Joab. I promise it's going to be intense. And then we're going to have this incredible discussion about chapter 14 of A Tale of Three Kings. You don't want to miss it. Put that in the chat box. Say, I don't want to miss it. I don't want to miss this. Now, also, Pastor Wooten, if you can put in the box over there so I can see who's online, that would be very helpful to me. Okay. So I am trying to get everybody. Always takes a minute for me to see who's online, and I like to see who's online so I can kind of welcome you. All right, it's coming. That is Brother MacGyver. One day I got in trouble. I asked a question. Somebody asked, well, if you were on a deserted island, who would you want with you? I said, Pastor Wooten. My wife got very angry with me. She said, you should go marry Pastor Wooten. I said, no. It's just that if I got stuck, I would want to get off to come back home to see you. And if I was on with you, I'd probably be stuck for the rest of my life. And Wooten would help me get off the island. So, he is a true blessing to this ministry. Thank God for the day that the Lord led him here. Wonderful individual, wonderful man of God. So Sister Ann Baker is here. Dina, our walking encyclopedia. We've got Yvonne is here. Priscilla's here. And that's all you YouTubers. Make sure you guys share and subscribe if you haven't. And then we have Debbie. She is our house administrative communicator, shall I call her. And so we are excited about all of you being online. So I want to, again, invite you, be here tonight. Whatever you got to do, 7 o'clock, we're going to set the atmosphere, and it's going to be absolutely awesome. So we are in Holy Week. Holy Week is a string of 8 days. Now, 8 is really prophetic because 8 is new beginnings. So I believe after we come off of these 8 days of prayer and fasting, you're going to enter a window of new beginnings. Put that in the chat box. New beginnings. And you're about to walk into new beginnings. How many of you are excited about your new beginnings? I'm not going to be in my old place. I'm going to be in a new place. I'm going to be in new beginnings. Holy Week is a string of 8 days that allow us an opportunity to reflect upon the shift in humanity. Jesus' sacrifices on the cross launched. So when his sacrifice on Calvary has shifted humanity into a place it has never returned from. And we are reflecting on his sacrifice. And that's why Paul said, present your body, what? A living sacrifice, holy or totally and acceptable unto God, which is only our reasonable service. It's only what we're supposed to do. I know we always want to get brownie points or get credit for doing the extra. But when Jesus dies on the cross, ain't too much extra we can do. But give ourselves over to him totally and completely. And again, that's why I love this book. I love it because it's a book on brokenness. It's a book on humility. And that's what Jesus demonstrated. As I taught you on Sunday, that was a problem that the Pharisees and the Sadducees had with Jesus because they wanted him to come as the king, restoring the throne of David back over to the Jews. And when he came riding a donkey, when he came broken and humility and healing the sick and opening up blinded eyes and doing miracles and feeding and ministering to the poor, they said, no, this is not the Messiah we want. They didn't want a Messiah of humility. They wanted one of power. And everybody's after power. And this book speaks to people who are hungry after power. As we see in our government today, there are people that will lie to a nation. And not only lie to a nation, they have lied so much to a nation that now the nation has eaten a lie. And I'm even talking to the evangelicals. You guys are amazing to me that you are so spiritual and have such discerning, and you cannot discern a lie, and you now take sin and you guys categorize it. The Bible says all unrighteousness is sin. So no matter what the sin is, on what side, you know, when it comes to Republican or Democrat, I think they all need to find Jesus. But don't categorize or calibrate. This sin is worse than no, all sin. All unrighteousness is sin. But you know what a lie is, and you know all lies shall have their part in the lake. So be careful. It starts with Palm Sunday when Jesus enters the city of Jerusalem. The week leads to the Last Supper, which we're going to have on Good Friday. We will be serving communion. You don't want to miss it. And I'm asking everybody to wear their white or that's close to you, what you have, beige, whatever you have. And if you can't, just be here. All right? His crucifixion, and it ends on Easter Sunday with his resurrection. So Sunday is going to be a celebratory day. We're going to praise God. We're going to shout. We're going to rejoice because our Savior, Jesus Christ, the King of Kings, got up from the grave. And because he got up, because he lives, we can live. Because he lives, we now have the right to eternal life. This is the basis of Christianity. As I told you before this, we don't even know what Christianity was. Jesus was a Jew. That's why he was in Jerusalem. Why? To celebrate the what? Shalomar. He was in Jerusalem to celebrate what? You know, we've got this delay that comes when I'm online, so I have to wait to see how fast you guys can respond to me. So I say something, it takes a couple seconds for you to hear me, and then I see how fast you can put me online. Yes, Dina, thank you. The Passover, that's pretty good. So he's there to celebrate the Passover. He's not there to celebrate his resurrection because he hasn't died and got up yet. Okay. His sacrifice launched the new covenant. God's promised, and many had prophesied throughout the Old Testament. Each day of the Holy Week allows us to peek into the heart of our Savior and intentively close proximity of his heart. We get a chance to inspect the heart, his love, his caring. His last great miracle was to bring his friend Lazarus back from the dead. How many know Jesus and this week wants to bring you back from the dead? Whatever is dead in your life, he wants to resurrect it. Your peace, your joy, your passion, your love. Let in this week of prayer and fasting him resurrect you. Put in the chat box, I want to be resurrected. Not a piece of me, all of me, all of my mind, my soul, my body. I want total, put in the chat box, total resurrection. What I want this week is total and complete. Everything in my life that is dead or dying, I want it to come alive. It's like I said, that scripture says, can a tree that is cut down, can it revive itself? Yes, that root can find water or spirit and be revived. I believe this is a week of being revived. It's a week of revival. It's a week of new revelation. And aren't you glad that you're a part of it? Yes, thank you, Debbie. I want to be resurrected. Everybody, put that in the chat box. I want it. Priscilla. I want total resurrection. I don't want a piece of it. I want all of it. I want the whole role. His love for us is reflected in every significant step towards the cross, every breath up to the last, and his resurrection. Total resurrection. My God, God is such a faithful God. And I mean, he's working miracles for us when we don't even know we're working miracles. Some of you are right in the middle of an unbelievable miracle. Somebody say unbelievable miracle. Unbelievable miracle. unbelievable miracle. Let's go over to the book of Ephesians. Ephesians 3. Let's go to Ephesians 3. Oh, this is one of my favorite all-time scriptures. Let me go to Amplified. Praying for Mother McFarland. I believe God is going to, I'm touching the grief for a miracle for her life. I rebuke every infirmity in her body. God, in this week of restoration and newness, I want us all to touch and agree for Mother McFarland, with his brother Kareem's mother. She was a faithful member here. She moved down to Florida with her children. But we're believing that the enemy has attacked her body. But I know God is a healer. And everything that's not like God, every infirmity, we speak death, kill it now in our body. And God, let her live. You said you came that she might have life, and not just life, but life in abundance. So let me read 19. So I'm reading Ephesians 3 and starting at verse 19. Can we do that? Write that down. Ephesians 3 and 19. Thank you, Debbie. That you may really come to know. I want you today, this week, I want you to pray, Lord, he said what? Learn of me. That's what he said. To learn of him means to know him. He wants you to know him. And this is what he says, learn of me because my yoke is what? Easy. And my burden, I want you to know me, because if you come to know me, you'll know that you can enjoy life in a way you're not enjoying it right now. There are levels of intimacy when you know a person. And if I really want to know you, what must I do? I must do what? If I really want to know you, then I must do what? Thank you, Priscilla. I must spend time with you. Time is your greatest asset. It is your greatest gift God ever gives anybody, time. And when you think about sometimes how much we've abused and misused our time, sometimes it can make you feel, oh my God, how could I have had something that was so valuable? Because I didn't realize how valuable it was. But now that I do, and now that I have an open door to learn him, you know, take anybody in life that you admire. You know, anybody, you know, maybe it was President Obama, maybe Michelle Obama. You know, maybe it was Dr. Martin Luther King. Maybe it was Sojourner Truth. Take anybody in history and say, oh, I admire that person. I wish they could have been my mentor. And then they said to you, come, learn of me. I'm inviting you to learn as much as you want. I'll tell you whatever you want to know. And then you don't take advantage of it. How horrible would that be? When Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the Creator of all things, the Savior of the world, now invites you, Priscilla, you, Ann Baker, you, Dina, you, Tuma. I hope I said it right, Tuma. Please tell me I said it right. Invites you personally to learn of him. He said, I left me in 66 books of the Bible. Every day you can read about me and then pray that I give you new revelation. Everybody say, new revelation. Oh my God. So it says, that you may really come to know practically through the experience for yourself. He said, experience me for yourself. Don't depend on someone else's testimony, someone else's praise. He said, I invite you to come know me for yourself. Put that chat box. I got to know him for myself. Christine, for myself. what to know for myself, the love of Christ, which far surpasses mere knowledge without experience. So he says, you don't really know my love. You don't know really know me without experience. Now this becomes the dilemma, Priscilla and Priscilla. Here is the dilemma. Tuma. Tuma. Am I saying it right? T. I'm still calling you T so I can't mess it up. That to know him means I need to reprioritize my life. To know him, I must take time to put him in the first position. I've got to reevaluate everything that's in my life and come to the true knowledge that he is the most important thing in my life. Why would I not want the life giver that gives me life, that gives me health, that gives me peace and joy, that gives me wisdom and knowledge? Why would I not want that person to be first in my life? Somebody help me. Toma. That's what I said. Toma, of course. Thank you. Oh, my God. Toma, thank you. So it says that you may be filled through all your being. This experience must fill you up from the crown of your head to the soles of your feet until all the fullness of God may have the richest measure of divine presence. That's what I said. When you really walk in God, there's an aura. Somebody say, I want that aura. I want that aura that when I walk down the street, people look at me strange. Not because I got a strange hairdo on. Not because my hair is some funny color, Christine. Or I got things hanging off my glasses, or I have some unusual outfit on, because the aura of God is on me. My smile, my presence. When I walk in a room where there's confusion, peace comes in. When I walk in a place where there's sickness, sickness goes out and healing comes in. That the joy of the Lord, I bring it wherever I go. I am a walking epistle. I am a living demonstration of the glory and the presence of God. And in his presence, there is liberty, freedom. In his presence, there is joy. It says, may have the richest measure of the divine presence and become a body wholly filled and flooded with God himself. You want to be flooded with God. I want to be flooded. Everybody say, I want to be in a flood. Flood me. Put that in the chat box. Say, flood me, Jesus. Flood me. Flood me. How many of you want to be flooded? I want you to drown me in your presence. I just don't want to be flooded. I want to be drowned. Drown me, Lord. Somebody tell God, say, Lord, drown me. Drown me in your presence, God. Monique, drown me. I want to go, just drown me. Let me die that you can live in me. Let me die. Now, here's 20. Here's my favorite part. Now to him who by in consequence of the action of his power that is in work within us, his power is at work within me. Someone said, tell your neighbor, say, the power is working in me. Tell your neighbor, the power is working in me. the power is working in me. Yeah, I want that aura, the power. Listen to this. The action of his power that is at work within me is able to carry out his purpose and do super abundantly, far above. He's going to do in you super abundantly. Everybody say super abundantly. Far up over and above all that you dare to ask. You wouldn't even ask God. You don't even have the capacity to ask. All that we dare ask or think. We can't even think. It is so, what he's about to do in you is so far your ability, you can't even imagine it. Listen to what the scripture says. Infinitely beyond our highest prayer. It's in an infinite space. You couldn't even pray it because you can't even think it. Our highest prayers, desires, thoughts, hopes, or dreams. What God is about to do is blow your mind. Everyone put that in the chat box. Say, Lord, blow my mind. Blow my socks off my feet. Blow my hair until it stands up straight on my head, God. Blow me away, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Blow, yes, Alonge? Blow my mind. Those are two verses you got to mark it down. Ephesians 3, 19 and 20. Now, I like to do this. I want to read this again. I want to read it in the King James Version as well. Kind of how we've all learned it. So let me read it in the King James Version. Oh, let me do this, and let me do this, and let me do this. Okay. 19 says, and to know the Lord, and to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge. See, when I know his love, it passes knowledge, that ye might be filled with all the fullness of God. That's why I want to learn him. I want to learn him because when I learn him, it passes knowledge. My God, he said, for lack of knowledge, we're destroyed. And me coming to know him passes knowledge, supersedes it. And in 20 says, now unto him that is able to exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think according to the power that worketh in us. Now unto him that is able to do. What is God ready to do in you if you just have the faith to believe it? This is Faith Clinic. I want to build your faith, Monique, till you know God is about to do something so awesome that we're all going to sit in church and we're all going to faint because we can't believe what God has just done. And how many know he can do it in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye? 21 says, unto him be the glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. Amen. So what an awesome God he is. The God that we love, a God that we serve, who desires just to do more and more for us. What a blessing. What a blessing. Now, Holy Week begins on Palm Sunday, as I said. It ends on Easter Sunday. During this 1 week, many biblical prophecies were fulfilled. So it is a, Priscilla, it is a week of fulfilling the prophetic word that was prophesied in the Old Testament. Now, Jesus becomes the fulfillment of that word. Jesus came to earth to save humanity by dying on the cross. What? On Good Friday. And resurrecting on Easter Sunday. By enduring and defeating death. He defeated death. That's why I said this is a time of total resurrection. That's what I want you to get to that. You're living, these 8 weeks represent total resurrection. Total, put that again, get it. Total resurrection. Every time you pray, I want to say, Lord, I thank you for total resurrection. Everything in my life that was dead, everything in my life that was dying, relationships, finance, health, whatever it is, it's being resurrected. He's not the God of one chance, a second chance. He's the God of a third chance, a fourth chance, a fifth chance. He's a God full of grace and mercy. By enduring and defeating death sacrificially for us, he swung open the gates of heaven, allowing our sins to be forgiven and ushering us into the presence of God. That's why we're going to praise God on Sunday. I don't know if I'm going to preach or not. We're just going to shout, praise God and shout, and praise God and shout, and dance and run. Why? Because he is risen. How many can shout, he is risen? Toma, he is risen. He is risen. Now we understand, due to the sinful nature of humanity as a result of Adam and Eve's fall in the Garden of Eden, it's impossible for us to be good enough to be in the presence of God and forgiven for our sins. Jesus died to make the way for salvation. The Old Testament law offered many sacrifices to God, but Jesus was the perfect atoning sacrifice once and for all. He endured the cross out of his love for us. He went through that death, that horrific, horrible, detesting death. The crucifixion of the Romans. Holy Week is a sacred opportunity to study the foundation of Christianity. Our God is not one of coincidence. I keep telling you that. He does nothing coincidentally. He's intentional. Put that in the chat box. He is what? Intentional. Every step towards the cross was intentional. Every lesson laced with his personal love for all of us. My friends, this is going to be such a powerful week. That's why you want to be in prayer. Tonight, prayer starts promptly at 6. We're going to pray right up until the beginning of the service. And then we're going to have this production. It's going to be right here in your face. I'm going to take you into the cave of David. There, David was going to be faced with his own family member, his own commanding officer of his army, Joab. And they will come face to face. And you don't want to miss it. I'm telling you, this book is going to come alive in this room tonight. And you've got to be here. Where? 215-32 Jamaica Avenue, Queens Village, New York. Tonight, this room becomes the Revelation Theater, the place where men and women, boys and girls come to receive a fresh revelation of God's word. You don't want to miss it. Put in that chat box, I won't miss it. If you're not going to miss it, be it online or live, just put it in your, I'm not going to miss it. And not only do I not want you not to miss it, but I want you to tell at least 10 people about it. I am so sure you're going to be so blessed tonight. How many of you are going to help me get the word out? Either online or in person. Pastor, I'm going to help you get the word out tonight. You can't afford to miss it. Got to be here. Bring everybody you know, your friends, your family. I promise you, you don't want to miss it. Some of you are going to be amazed at what you see tonight. Would you help me get the word out? 7 o'clock. We're going to transform this space. And you're going to be in the cave of David and his mighty men. At a crucial hour in the life of David, when we will face to face and ask David that ultimate question. Why, David? Why? Oh my God, I can't wait till tonight. I can feel chills right now. You got to be here. Get your children there. Bring your enemies there. Oh yeah, all of them. Because you're going to hear the heart of a man. You're going to even understand why they said of David that he was a man after God's own heart. Tonight, that part of David gets revealed. And so you, again, do not want to miss tonight. Oh, my God, I'm telling you, I'm just so excited about it. And don't forget, we're in prayer. Now, don't forget Friday. Friday is Good Friday. We'll be serving communion Good Friday. Prayer starts at 12 noon. We'll be in prayer from 12 to 6. We will have intermittent breaks as we have a number of wonderful people in our house who are going to be sharing the 7 last statements of Jesus during that critical hour of his dying. What was going through his mind? What was his thoughts? What did it mean? How does that now affect our thoughts? Many of you are going to be amazed to hear some of our, we got our own brother McMillan's coming, Fred McMillan, and got our own Pastor Wooten's going to be sharing. Our own Sister Raquel is going to be hosting along with myself. Keisha Brown, who y'all enjoy praying, she's going to be sharing the word. Oh, she has the power. Father, forgive them. Oh, wow. I think Mother Hamilton has, I thirst. You want to be here. So it's going to be Friday. It's going to be just awesome. And then 7 o'clock service, we go in, serving communion, praising, worshiping God. What a mighty God we serve. That's all I know. And don't forget, the fast will end Saturday evening, 6 p.m. The last 24 hours are dry. Total sacrifice. But what is that for Christ who died for us and gave his entire being for our benefit? Wow, God is something else. Look at somebody say, God is something else. God is. Oh, I love Jesus. I love Jesus. How many of y'all love Jesus? How many of y'all love Jesus? Today's Wednesday. Did you ever think, what happened the Wednesday before Resurrection Sunday? You ever thought about that, Priscilla? What happened Wednesday before Resurrection Sunday? Today's Wednesday, Crystal. Though the Gospel of Luke states every day he was teaching in the temple, Holy Wednesday, every day is holy. It's Holy Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Holy Wednesday is referred to as a day of rest for Jesus. While in Bethany, a woman anointed Jesus' feet with perfume. Remember? Today, I want us to get down and anoint his feet. See, when you anoint someone's feet, when you wash their feet, it means brokenness, humility. You remember what Jesus told? Maybe we should do that for Good Friday. You remember when Jesus told Peter? Peter said, I'm not washing your feet. No, he says, Peter told Jesus, you're not washing my feet. And Jesus said, Peter, if I don't wash your feet, I have no part of you, Peter. If I can't wash your feet, if I can't demonstrate that the Son of God has enough humility to bow down and wash your feet, I have nothing to do with you. You cannot take away from me the opportunity, Peter, to wash your feet. See, actually, David, do you have that kind of humility? Yes, Priscilla, from Friday to Saturday. Ask yourself that question. Do you have enough humility to wash someone's feet? See, the act is a representation of brokenness and humility. It is also widely known that throughout the church as Spy Wednesday. While Jesus rests in Bethany at the home of Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, the plot of the high priest and the authorities to kill Jesus is in full swing. Finding an open opportunity in the greed of Judas, Satan enters him. Judas went to the chief priests and authorities, and from that moment he sought an opportunity to portray his Lord, his Savior, his friend. He would soon betray Jesus for the peace or for the price of a slave, for a piece of silver. And the 12 would scatter. None of the 12 will be left at the foot of the cross as Jesus dies, but John. His homies, as they say on the street, is his boys, his road dogs, are all going to run away, all but John. Judas betrays the very man who he followed for years. That's why you can be in the church and still be a traitor. But because of Spy Wednesday, we see yet another prophecy fulfilled from the Old Testament. Judas's role fulfills words declared hundreds of years before and further proves the validity of the Bible and Christianity. So we understand Judas is a fulfillment of the Old Testament prophecy that he would be betrayed. Oh, but God is faithful. Oh, how do you know God is faithful? God is faithful. Now, this is interesting. Now, we call Holy Thursday. On Holy or Thursday is an upper room. Jesus and the disciples share the Last Supper. On this day, Jesus washed the feet of his disciples, broke bread with them for the last time. Still celebrated today as part of many congregational traditions, the bread broken and the wine shared represents the body and blood of Christ to be broken and shed for the disciples, for us, all of us. During the meal, Jesus predicted his betrayal, but one of them and Peter's denial. After the meal, the disciples accompanied Jesus to the Garden of Gethsemane. Oh my God. Gethsemane, what does Gethsemane mean? Somebody tell me for a minute. Let's see if I can get Dina, my walking encyclopedia. What does Gethsemane mean? Wait for a minute. What does Gethsemane mean? I'm waiting. I want to try to wait on this one. Oh, I see. Thomas said sorry. Or sorrow, no. Right, yeah, it means the place of the oil press. It means the place oil press, right. Christine, I see you would use Google. Oil press. We all must have a Gethsemane in our lives. Put that in and say, I must have a Gethsemane in my life. I must have a Gethsemane experience in my life. It is the place that we get pressed out. If I need olive oil in order to get it, I must take the olive and what? I must crush it. I must squeeze it. Oh, God, help me. Soma, you coming to church, Soma? Soma, I want to answer. When are you coming to church? Soma, when are you coming to church? Yes. I must be pressed. Say that, I must be pressed. I don't want to be pressed. I know y'all don't want to be pressed. I don't want to be pressed. But you must be pressed. God must get the oil out of you. God must get the oil out of you. The oil has the value, but he has to press it out of you. Ooh. Oh, yes, Lord. Think about what olive oil symbolizes. Of course, we know it was good for the anointing process. And so it was used also for a lotion for skin and your hair in the Bible. Today we have found out even more purposes of olive oil. So when God brought it to the, it's like when you think about you, we got to draw the parallel. Everybody say, draw the parallel. Okay, how about now, Priscilla? Okay, so we have olive oil is something you should have a little bit every night. Literally drink a little bit. Has a large amount of antioxidants in it. It is a strong inflammatory. It means that, you know, you got joints that are inflamed. helps kill the inflammation in your joints. It helps to prevent strokes. Strokes are caused by a disturbance of blood flow to your brain, either due to a blood clot or bleeding. In developed nations, stroke is the second most common cause of death, right behind heart disease. The relationship between olive oil and strokes have been studied extensively. A large review of studies of 841,000 people found that olive oil was the only source of monounsaturated fat associated with a reduced risk of stroke or heart disease. In another review in 140,000 participants, those who consumed olive oil were at a much lower risk of stroke than those who did not. Also protects against heart disease. Olive oil is not associated with weight gain, and obesity. Olive oil may fight, they believe, Alzheimer's and dementia. Olive oil may reduce type 2 diabetes. It is has anti-cancer properties. It's antibacterial properties. The bottom line is that olive oil is potent and powerful. So that's why God wants to get what's in you out of you. Because you have authority, you have power within you. But he's got to squeeze you to get you out of it. Will you let him squeeze you? Will you let him crush you? That's the question. So, tonight's tonight. Now, I want to give you a chance on this Holy Wednesday to sow. As in everyone, I asked all of y'all on Faith Clip, everybody to sow a minimum, small $20 seed. So, everybody can do that. Y'all know how to give. Let's plant today that $20 seed, everybody. If you're sowing, just put in the chat box. I'm sowing, Pastor. I'll put it on the side. I've got that $20 seed. I'm sowing that $20 seed. Not even a thought, Pastor. Take it. My page, I put it on in my faith clinic seed. Now, because we're operating in faith, I never stop people who, if God is talking to you to sow 40 or 100 or 1,000. You might be in that place, I know God is talking to me, and I need to sow this seed. The greater the seed, the greater the harvest. But I'm sowing good. Earlene, so hi, Earlene. Mission Earlene. Toma, sowing. Thank you, all you that are sowing, sowing, sowing. I know you were blessed today because I was blessed. Every time I get blessed, I know I'm blessing somebody. I know I was shepherding you today. So I'm looking forward to seeing all of you tonight, either in person or online. Tonight, where? Revelation Theater. Tonight, you will have a new revelation of brokenness, humility, and the heart of David. Well, until next Tuesday, 12 noon, Faith Clinic. You go with God, and God certainly will go with you. And remember, here at Greater Bethel, we're changing the world. How are you doing it, Pastor? One heart, one mind, one person at a time. God bless you.